If I eat too much of this, am I gonna overdose? How about too much of this, huh? How do you overdose on stuff? Hey everyone, thank you for watching DNews today. I'm Trace. Overdosing is a terrible thing, and although it's commonly associated with opiate drugs, you can actually overdose on a bunch of seemingly harmless other things. Recently, a case study published in Pediatric Neurology described a boy in Italy with seizures, headaches, and high blood pressure. After a week in the hospital, doctors noticed that the boy's teeth were black. It took them a week to notice that? What? It turns out the kid has been eating 20 licorice candies every day for the last 4 months. Sidebar, we call it black licorice in the US. Everybody else in the world just calls it licorice. The red things that we eat, they don't even contain licorice. Back to the story. Licorice has been used as a medicine for over 4,000 years and comes from the extract of the licorice root, which contains glycyrrhizic acid. The acid is 50 times sweeter than sugar and used to treat chronic hepatitis, inflammation, ulcers, liver damage, and even viruses. Eating too much caused the boy's body to freak out, so they stopped his excessive consumption and he returned to normal. He overdosed on licorice, guys. The moral of this story, you can overdose on a lot of things. For instance, if you were hospitalized because of irregular heartbeat, restlessness, vomiting, muscle tremors, insomnia, anxiety, and headaches, that would be pretty serious, right? Those are the symptoms of a caffeine overdose. You could even fall into a coma and die if you consumed an excessive amount. Caffeine is one of the most commonly abused self-medications in the world. 80% of the inhabitants of affluent countries drink coffee or tea daily, and more than 600 to 900 milligrams of caffeine a day is an overdose. For measure, one tall, that's 12 ounce, Starbucks blonde roast coffee contains 260 milligrams of caffeine. You can do that math. Yikes. But no one worries about that. Instead, we worry about mercury contamination in fish. A study in Biology Letters in 2010 found bluefin and big eye tuna contain more methylmercury in their muscles than other species. But while overdosing on methylmercury can cause irreversible brain damage, to find out how much that would be depends on the fish, where it came from, how much you ate, your body mass, how frequently you eat that fish, which is why the FDA recommends no more than 6 ounces or one tuna steak meal per week. Tomatoes and potatoes can cause solanine poisoning, but you'd have to eat so many of them to overdose. 67 potatoes in a single sitting is calculated by one website, so it's kind of crazy to think about. Not to mention the human body can only process 2,000 milligrams per day of ascorbic acid or vitamin C. Carrots, oranges, strawberries, peppers, they all contain vitamin C, and if you overeat those foods while taking, say, vitamin C supplements, you could conceivably end up consuming more than your body could clean out. That would cause vomiting, heartburn, headache, kidney stones, digestive problems like diarrhea and cramps. And if you ate over 11,000 milligrams of vitamin C, it could maybe possibly kill you, but that's a lot, that's ridiculous. Even water can kill. Too much water dilutes the electrolytes in the body, throwing the water-sodium balance off and causing death by water intoxication. While relatively uncommon, it does happen, usually as part of a mental illness like compulsive drinking or miseducation of lifestyle choices. So for one 2000 New England Journal of Medicine study, it found 13% of Boston Marathon runners had extremely low sodium in their blood. And in 2007, a woman actually died during a radio station contest from water intoxication. So I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Everything in moderation, guys. But what do you think about all this? Let us know down in the comments. Make sure you subscribe so you get more DNews. And if you like this, and you like thinking about contamination and food, check out Seeker. They just did an episode about how the Japanese tsunami completely changed one way to manufacture food. It's really cool. Check it out.
Shimamura was first inspired as a teenager when he visited a vegetable factory. So the idea of indoor farming wasn't new, but the tsunami disaster was the catalyst that spurred him into action.
You can go down into the description and find a link to subscribe and watch the video. Thanks for watching.